Is a health savings account a good option for you? And if you have one, are you maximizing the benefits of it? In this video, I'm going to cover the positives and negatives of HSAs, and then I will reveal the biggest mistake that 95% of HSA owners make. And finally, I'll share my own personal strategy on how to supercharge one of the best features of an HSA. Welcome to Healthy, Wealthy, and Wise, where we talk about little things that can lead to big improvements in our financial and physical health. My name is Kevin, and I want to thank you for clicking on this video. And if you like it, please hit that like button. And also, don't be afraid to subscribe because, after all, it's free, and it'll make sure you don't miss any upcoming videos. Now let's talk about this crazy year of 2020, where you may be in a situation reassessing your healthcare needs and options due to an unexpected job loss or job change, and may now be considering an HSA. Or maybe you already have an HSA, but have heard about an extension and making a contribution for 2019 and was wondering what that's all about. Either way, I'm going to give you some information that will help you in making an informed decision. If you're wondering what an HSA is, let's first talk about what it isn't. Many people confuse an HSA with a flexible spending account, or FSA, which is an account run by your employer where you can put aside pre-tax money for healthcare expenses with the understanding that you have to use that money for that year. It's a use it or lose it account, and there can be a lot of headaches with this and accurately planning how much expenses you will incur in an upcoming year. A health savings account is very different in that you actually own the account and can take the money with you if you leave your job. Also, it's not a use it or lose it account. Your money can roll over from year to year without any penalty. And another exciting difference between an FSA and HSA is that you can invest the money of your HSA, which is not an option for an FSA. We'll be talking much more about this in a little bit. Now, if you're considering signing up for an HSA, you also have to sign up for a qualifying high deductible healthcare plan to be eligible. For 2020, the minimum deductible for a high deductible healthcare plan is $1,400 for an individual and $2,800 for a family. Another criterion to be eligible is that the out-of-pocket maximum for an HSA qualified health plan cannot be more than $6,900 for individual coverage or $13,800 for family coverage. When signing up for a plan, an insurer will generally let you know if it's HSA eligible. If they don't, you will want to contact them to check into that. So why would you want to sign up for a high deductible plan? Well, there are some good reasons. If you are relatively healthy and don't typically have a lot of medical expenses, then a high deductible plan might be a great option for you because your premiums are often significantly less than lower deductible plans. Also, many employers will put some money into your account for you, so that's basically free money given to you, just like if your employer puts a match into a 401k. Now, on the other hand, if you don't like high deductibles, you plan to receive a higher amount of medical services, or don't have money set aside for unexpected medical expenses, then an HSA may not be for you. But I would challenge you to look at the difference in the cost of your premiums over the year, and you may be surprised in how much the low deductible plans actually cost. When I was looking at my options last year, my company's low deductible plan would cost me about $180 every 2 weeks out of my paycheck, or close to $4,700 over the course of the year, whereas the high deductible plan cost me about $50 every 2 weeks, or $1,300 for the year. So over the course of the year, I would pay almost $3,400 more out of my paycheck for the low deductible plan. However, by signing up for the HSA, my company also put $500 into my accounts, so I really came out almost $4,000 better, and since I had low medical needs, I came out way ahead on an HSA. Okay, now the exciting part about HSAs are the ability to invest the money in your account and all of the tax benefits that go with this. You may have heard people talk about the triple tax benefits of HSAs, and you start to realize that they are not just for your health, but also can help create wealth. Two of the major things this channel is about. So let's go over the three tax benefits. One, the contributions you make to the account are tax-free. Two, any withdrawals you make for qualified health expenses are not taxed. And number three, any money invested in the account grows tax-free. This last part is super exciting because of the implications. and notable because about 95% of HSA accounts have no investments, which means that there is no opportunity for the money to significantly grow. You could receive interest in the account, but we know how low interest rates are now and how little that will produce. So to clarify, 95% of people are only using their HSA to pay for health expenses completely tax-free. And that's not a bad thing. And if it's difficult to put much more money into your account because of other life expenses, then that's what you have to do. In this case, I would recommend that you at least contribute enough money into your account that covers the deductible on your plan so that you're not left with the stress of having to pay a lot of money for unexpected medical expenses. Now, if you have the ability to put a little extra money into your account, I want you to start thinking of how your HSA can not only become a place to hold tax-free money for medical expenses, but as a place to grow money tax-free that can help you big time in retirement. And I would say that if you're someone that is actively planning for retirement, an HSA should be something you absolutely consider. I would even argue that it could be a wiser decision to fully fund your HSA before an IRA, or even a 401k above any money you have to put in to get your full employer match. You always want to get that full match of free money when you can. Does this sound crazy? Well, let me tell you why it's not. Because let's say you put the money in your HSA and never need to take out any withdrawals for healthcare expenses. Well, when you turn 65, then your HSA becomes effectively like an IRA, where you can take the money out penalty-free for any reason, when it will be then be taxed at your current income tax rate, unless it's for healthcare expenses, which then you can withdraw tax-free. And over the years, because your money was invested, it actually has grown to be more than what you originally put into the account. Okay, now I'll share with you my ultimate strategy that is good for anyone that does not absolutely need to use their HSA to pay for expenses at the time you incur them. It just requires a little bit of organizational skills. And that is, for co-pays or small medical costs, I just pay out of my pocket and don't take a withdrawal from my HSA. Again, only because I don't absolutely need to get reimbursed at that time. But I keep the receipts in a folder labeled unreimbursed medical expenses, and keep in mind that they do have to be for dates after I established my HSA. And this is where it's great. So the money I don't take out for the healthcare expense, I let it grow by investing it in my HSA, with the annualized returns of about 7%, compounded year over year. And then once I retire, or if I find myself out of work, I can get tax-free withdrawals from my HSA using my old unreimbursed healthcare receipts. And those receipts can be from 20 years ago. This is another great benefit of an HSA that I find many people that have them don't realize. You don't have to pull money out of your HSA to get reimbursed for medical expenses in the same year that you incurred the expense. And in this way, I can maximize all three of the major tax benefits of HSAs, which again, 95% of people with HSAs don't do. So now you're thinking maybe an HSA is for you, right? Well, let me share with you the HSA contribution limits that are set annually by the IRS. For 2020, they are $3,550 for individual coverage and $7,100 for family. Keep in mind, if the employer puts in money for you, then that counts against the limit. So for example, if your employer puts $500 into your account, then you can only put in $3,050 to reach the max contribution for individual coverage. If you're age 55 or older, you can save an extra $1,000 each year to play catch up. With these annual limits, an HSA could never replace an IRA or a 401k, but could definitely play a role in your retirement planning. Now, a lot of this sounds really good, but there are some major things that you have to keep in mind when making this decision, the negatives. One big thing to keep in mind is that if you would ever need to pull money out of an HSA before you are 65 years old, and that the money is not used for healthcare expenses, you would face a 20% penalty plus any taxes that may be due. The other major thing to remember, just like any investment, there are no guarantees that you will have positive returns and could even lose money. However, history shows us that investments over time greatly outpace interest earned in savings accounts and inflation. So if you have a weak stomach when the market has a downturn, which as we know happens this year all too well, then the investment part of an HSA may not be for you. Although, keep in mind that you will likely have a lot of options within your HSA brokerage account that are less risky. So you may have heard that due to the unexpected events of this year, that the deadline to file your federal taxes and make contributions to your IRA and HSA have been extended to July 15th. If you had an HSA in 2019 and didn't reach the maximal contributions for that year, $3,500 for individuals and $7,000 for families, plus the extra $1,000 if you're 55 or older, then you can make a contribution to your HSA up to that limit. You will just want to make sure it's labeled for 2019. That will lower your taxes for the year. For state taxes, you will want to check out with your specific state for details. Well, that was a lot of information. I would love for you to comment on if you would like more detailed information on HSAs, and specifically what you would like to know more about them. I was thinking about doing a comparison with IRAs and 401ks to see if, you know, if there's interest. This channel is for you, and I want to talk about the things that you're interested in. I hope you have found this information helpful, and if you did, once again, please subscribe to the channel. As always, I hope that we can all learn from each other on how to take little easy steps in making big improvements in our lives. Thank you again for watching, and until next time, have a great day.